Well, big good morning to you on Sunday, the 3rd of July. Welcome to all of you online coming in with us this morning. And for those of you who are going to be joining us on Catch Up, if you've just picked up this message, this service, we know that you're going to have a great time with us today. Lots happening here at BCC in Bromley as I look to the room and people are coming in. Just want to say today is going to be a very fun day. It's probably feeling a bit warm in here because the baptistry, the baptism pool is full. There'll be people being baptized in the second service. So we've opened all the windows just to let some air circulate, which is going to be good. So this morning I've got a verse, or three verses in fact. Psalm 145, verses 1 to 3. These are verses written by King David, and he's expressing what's in his heart. And when we come to worship this morning, and worship, we want to express our heart to God. Do we want God to hear us? Do we want God to know that we are here, to register who we are, to sense our appreciation of him? The answer is, of course, yes. And so we're going to do that this morning. Verse 1 says, I will extol you, my God and my King, and praise your name forever and ever. Sounds like an eternal thing. He had a sense of the future, didn't he? And verse 2, I will praise you every day. Yes, I will praise you forever. So he's affirming that. And then verse 3, great is the Lord. He is most worthy of praise. No one can measure his greatness. Well, you may think, well, that's pretty obvious because he's God. Well, but our response to that is not obvious. Our response to his greatness needs to reflect his greatness, which means that when we stand and when we worship, we can absolutely just extol him, recognize him, and in a sense, acknowledge who he is. So this morning we're going to stand. So let's stand. I'm just going to pray for one moment and then we're going to go straight into what is probably quite a lively song. So I hope you've got your vocal cords in gear, guys. Those of you online, just clear your throats. Here we go. So Lord God, we just thank you that you are immeasurably great. Lord, that you are way above and beyond. Lord, even our thoughts and our imagination, Lord. Lord, the greatness of our God is immense. So this morning as we come worshiping you, Lord Jesus, we come extolling who you are and thanking you for all that you have done for us. Lord, for being with us in every challenging situation, in every exciting situation. And so today, Lord, today is a celebration day for us as a church. Lord, with so much happening, with earthquake tonight, with baptisms in the next service, with everything that's going to happen in this service, we just thank you, Lord God, that you are here, that you are leading, guiding, that your love and your power is strong as it's ever been and will become stronger and stronger in each one of us. So today, Lord, we come to you with open hearts, wanting to praise you with everything in us in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Come on.
So long to my clap your hands and say,
lost another one. I am free. I am free. I
come on, let me hear you declare. Say,
heaven's lost another one. I am free.
I can hear you.
I am free.
I am free.
to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Jesus.
Like us to close our eyes for a moment. You know, we sang a song a few moments ago about the power of God, about the power of God. And as I'm standing there, I'm thinking, you know, I believe in the Pentecostal power of the Holy Spirit, not a religious denomination. I believe in the now present power of God to change situations and lives. And God tells us that if we pray believing, He can do miracles in our lives. And if you are in a situation where you need God to break through in an area of the miraculous, we're going to focus on that right now. And maybe that's an area of personal healing. We're going to take that moment, a moment right now, in the name of Jesus, to raise our faith and pray healing and breakthrough in whatever that situation is. If you've got both, then God's going to bless you doubly. But if you want healing, if you feel comfortable, put your hand wherever you feel that healing needs to take place. And if it's something in your situation, just raise your hands to God. Now, those of you online, just join in with this, because God can reach wherever you are. It's not just in this room. And I'm going to pray that the power we sang about a few moments ago would touch our lives in whichever way we know that is important right now. So, Father, we thank you that there is power in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Lord, that we can stand knowing that we trust completely the word of God that says if we pray and we believe, the miraculous can happen. And so, Lord God, right now in Jesus' name, I speak healing over every person watching this service, involved in this service, Whatever that place of healing needs to be, we declare healing in the name of Jesus. We speak healing in the powerful name of Jesus. And where there are breakthroughs needed right now, Lord, we call on you. We draw your attention to those needs. And we say, Father, we trust you with all our hearts. And we know that you are the one who can bring a breakthrough in the most difficult situations. So, Lord God, we now thank you. We thank you, anticipating, Lord, what you will do. So, Father, we thank you for all you have done, all that you are doing, and all that you will do. In the name of Jesus, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. And everybody said, amen. You know, I think sometimes people think you've got to hype these things up. It's not about hype. It's about the Holy Spirit touching that point in your life, on your journey, that means the most. And when we trust God, he does stuff. So who knows what could happen during this coming week, a week of prayer and fasting. Anyway, take your seats before we get too carried away. We'll start earthquake right now. Maybe, how about that? But if you're new to the church, welcome. But we're going to continue with our worship and just remind ourselves of a scripture reference as we go into our offering time. And from the outset, I just want to say again, thank you, church, for your faithfulness, your just willingness to trust God in the area of finance, the fact that you have unconditionally given back to God what he has already given to you. I know he sees it, and I know that he is blessing lives and he is providing for your now and your future. And I just want to encourage us really with scripture this morning. 2 Corinthians 9 verses 6 and 7 says, remember this. In other words, we're kind of prone to forgetting. Human beings forget. We forget stuff. Remember this. A farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop, but the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. Number 7, verse 7. You must each decide in your heart how much to give, and don't be reluctant or give reluctantly or in response to pressure. For God loves a person who gives cheerfully. Why? Because cheerfulness comes out of a knowledge that God is the provider. That's why. And if you're not at that place where you grasp that, that's a journey to go on and discover. And that's a faith journey. And so we want to encourage people to discover what it is to give faithfully and also sacrificially. We praise God for the resource he gives us as individuals and as a body of believers. And we thank God that we're able to release the finances into kingdom purpose. And those online, you can see on screen ways to give. And there are cards on our seats in the room here for, with QR codes if you want to give in the room. So, Father, we thank you that you have been so faithful to us, that, Lord, you encourage us in the scriptures to remember that you provide the seeds. Lord, you provide the ability to produce harvest. And thank you, Father, that you do that. Lord, thank you that your supernatural presence brings us to that place. And so, Lord, thank you. Lord, we just pray for families who may be at a place of pressure right now. We pray that you, God, will bless them and that you would honor their faithfulness in financial giving, Lord, today. And Lord, that we would be wise with all the things that are going on in the life of the church and the kingdom of God around us. We pray, Lord, you help us to choose wisely where we apply the finance that's released. Lord God, bless giving in this place, we pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So big welcome to you all. And great big welcome to you this Sunday, 3rd of July. And to those online who have joined us as the service has started, those in the room who've joined us as the service has started. So it's going to be a full-on day today. You've got a baptism service in a few minutes, but or in the next service. But I just want to just remind people that there's a whole kids program operating on site, not in this room. But if you've got a restless child who is in the room, then we have a facility, like an emergency facility with media, etc., just through the doors. And the welcome team can let you know about that. So tonight is earthquake. So just to prompt, to take a moment on this. Earthquake, if you are new, and there are many people joining the church regularly, I just want to encourage, we'll have people coming from around the country probably, they may be traveling this morning, to be with us this evening. Every quarter as a church, we believe in the power of prayer. We believe so much in the power of prayer, and our values start with determined devotion to God. That's what we hold as a value. It's one of our six core values as a church, determined devotion to God. And so every quarter, we have a week of prayer and fasting. And we start that week of prayer and fasting with a powerful time of worship and trusting God that the Holy Spirit will lead, guide, prophetically speak, touch people's lives, recharge batteries, bring people to a place of strength. And that will be happening tonight. So do come along tonight at 6:30. It's going to be brilliant. And it will finish around 8 o'clock or maybe just after. Those who can't join us can join by Zoom tonight. There's a sort of private Zoom link, but that's in our church e-news. So do look out for that. Also, just a word about the week of prayer and fasting. It is a food fast, primarily. It is about giving up food. Now, some of you can't because of medical reasons. Some of you just can't do it for some reason. But we don't want you to be under pressure. We just want to encourage you. We want to motivate each other that actually giving up food in a fast is saying no to the flesh and yes to the Spirit of God. That's what we're doing. We're saying, Holy Spirit, you're the one who is in us. You're the one who is leading and guiding us. So we're going to say, you know what? We're going to trust in you specifically this coming week. And so if you are able to give up food across the week for a day or a couple of days or the whole week and just drink water, just sensibly do that, especially as the weather's getting hot, we encourage you to do that. And then join us for prayer meetings every night this coming week at 8 o'clock. The combination of online and in-person meetings. You need to look into our newsletter for that electronically. There'll be an in-person Zoom and in-person meeting on Wednesday and on Friday evening. And there's a whole program of things to focus on. There'll also be an early morning online Zoom prayer meeting on Friday morning for those who really like to do things from the get-go at the first thing in the morning, which, of course, is a great time. Anyway, so that's that. If you have any questions, speak to me or the welcome team, and they can navigate to get information for you. We also have next Sunday, so this time next week, we will be celebrating again. We will be having our International Feast, Summer International Feast 2022. And we encourage you to invite friends. We encourage you to make food. We encourage you to bring enough food to feed all the people you're bringing, including your friends. We encourage you to wear something that symbolizes your country of heritage, and wear that with pride, because we want to celebrate the nations and the cultures represented in our church. So come along. It'll be after the second service next week, and it will kick off just after 1 o'clock, and it will run throughout the afternoon. It will be fantastic. Are you looking forward to it? Yes, three people. No, I know you are. There will be hundreds of people on site. So do think about this and invite friends and come along. Also, just to say that today we have a photographer. Where is he? I've lost him. He's gone to the other side. Gone to the other side. So if you don't like to be photographed, just be aware that we've got some photography taking place around the site this morning because it's a special day. So. Anyway, don't be put off by that. So baptism next service, do stay and be blessed with that. And also just want to say, yesterday, brilliant day, Georgina O'Hara graduated from IBTI. Why don't you stand up, Georgina? We have a picture. John White, the acting principal of IBTI, handed her graduation certificate. And a whole load of us from the church went down there to support her. So well done. And welcome back to all students who are coming back from university slowly, I think. So welcome back. Right, we're going to go straight to features and then the incredible. I'll just stop there, otherwise I'm creating a problem for myself, aren't I, Brian? We'll be speaking after the features.
And prayer, listen, prayer is what pushes the kingdom of darkness back. It's what pushes it back. That's why Jesus said, my house shall be called not a house of good preaching, not a house of good singing, not a house of great spotlights and production, not a house of great cafes. I hope you have all of that. Enjoy it. But Jesus said at the end of the day, my house better be called a house of prayer. Because spotlights and fog machines and great singing and great preaching, that won't necessarily push the kingdom of darkness back. But when my people who are called by my name, when they will humble themselves and when they'll pray, he says that I'm gonna hear from heaven. I'm gonna heal the land. The enemy will have to bend the knee at the name of Jesus in prayer.
Okay, good morning, morning. Everyone. Morning, morning. God is good, isn't he? So my young people are going out to their activities. That's great. Great quick clip there by Priscilla Shearer. That's it, isn't it? I encourage you to read her books on prayer and watch that film called The War Room. It's encouraging us in prayer. Really good. Great woman of God she is. Really is. Okay. Excellent. Well, it's good to bring the Word of God this morning. It really is. And what's our subject today? Well, our subject is stepping into the call of God. Stepping into the call of God. You know, I was just thinking about that video. And we're all preparing food this week, aren't we? Our different dishes. During a week of fasting. Isn't that difficult, isn't it? You're preparing all this lovely food. But anyway. Here we go. All right, okay. So, stepping into the call of God. Right. Well, what do I mean? You know, when I say, I've got a couple of questions to ask you. And the first question this morning is, what is the call of God? Because you may hear that, and it does appear in the scriptures. It talks about being called. But what does it actually mean? And what's the difference between the general call of God and the specific call of God? Because there is a difference there. And how do we know the call of God? And what stops us from fulfilling the call of God? I've just thrown four questions at you there, I know. But these are the sort of things I'm going to look at today, because it's important to understand what that is. You know, every believer in Jesus has the call of God upon their lives. Okay, every single one. You know, in Matthew 22 and verse 14, right at the end of the parable of the wedding feast, Jesus says these words, "Many are called, but few are chosen." What does that mean? What does that mean in that context? Well, what Jesus is doing really with what he's saying there is he is summarizing really the message of the Bible to all of us today and to everyone who's listening online as well. Now, the Bible calls us into a saving relationship with Jesus, into a faith relationship with God. That is what the message of the Bible is right the way through. So when the Israelites are called out of Egypt, he calls them into a relationship with him. Okay, that's the first thing. He gives them the law to tell them how to live right, but actually it is a faith-based relationship. That's the call of God on their lives. And when they came into the promised land, if you know, read the Old Testament, you will know it's a struggle. It's a continual struggle. They're always Jacob wrestling with the angel. They always are, and he sometimes calls them Jacob because of that. But he sent them prophets to bring them into that right relationship and to remind them of that faith-based relationship as well. So that is the message of the Bible. When we come to the New Testament, what are the first words of the New Testament when it comes to the gospel? Well, it is the words of John the Baptist. And he said this, his message, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." That's when he began his ministry. "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Then when Jesus began his public ministry, and we read this in Matthew chapter 4 and verse 17, the next chapter from that one. "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." He said the same words that John had said. And then at the birth of the early church in Acts chapter 2 in verse 38, the first sermon of Peter as the then leader of the Jerusalem church, he said, "Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins." And that message has gone out. Okay, that message was narrower to a specific group who came to hear John than to those who came to hear Jesus. But this message that went to the Jewish audience at the time now goes out to the world. "Repent, every one of you, and be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins." That is a general call upon everybody's life. Everybody who's listening to me today, even on catch up, that is the call upon your life, that God calls you into a relationship with him. In Acts chapter 9, we find a very angry young man. We find the 2,000-year-old equivalent of a Mossad agent. Okay? This is Saul, the rabbi, who is an angry young man. Okay? He was going to hunt down believers in Jesus and chain them and bring them back to Jerusalem for punishment. That was his soul game. That was what he thought was his call upon his life, okay? He thought God had called him to hunt down followers of Jesus and to arrest them. That was what it was. If you go to Covent Garden, Church of St. Paul there, or St. Paul's Church in Covent Garden, you will see this statue. Not particularly historically accurate. He wouldn't have been on a horse and he wouldn't have been wearing Roman clothes. But nonetheless, they're trying to depict the call. So this is supposed to be a photo of Saul on the Damascus Road and what happened to him there. This dramatic experience of God meeting him head on and saying, "You are not going my way. I want you to go another way. Now, we may not all have that sort of experience in our life. but nonetheless, there has to be a point in our life where we say, yes, I'm going to surrender my life to Jesus. And what was the purpose of God? Okay, he was called into a relationship with God at that point. But what was the purpose of Paul's life, as he was later known to be called? Well, God didn't tell Paul at first. He told Ananias, who went to pray for him. And a couple of weeks ago, we had a great Bible study. Brenda led an excellent Bible study in our life group on this subject. So you've inspired me, Brenda, to talk about this chapter today. But Ananias was given a message by God about Paul. He said this. This is about Paul. He is a chosen vessel of mine to bear my name before Gentiles, kings, and the children of Israel. So there was a purpose behind his calling. And what was Saul's response? Okay, so he spent some time with some other followers of Jesus in Damascus. But what did he do first of all? It says in verse 20 of Acts chapter 9, immediately he preached Jesus in the synagogues that he is the Son of God. Why did he do that? Because that is the general call of all of us who are believers in Jesus. It is to preach the gospel. It is to bring the gospel through our life and through our words. That is the call of God upon our life. If you go back to Matthew 28, and you might be saying, what do I do? Well, Matthew 28, 19, 20, a very familiar verse. And when I start saying it, you're going to know what it says if you don't know it already. Because this is a message for all of us today. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. That is the general call of God upon our lives. Whatever our circumstances are, whatever the situation is, in word and in deed, the call is the gospel. Yeah. Yeah. The call is to share Jesus. The call is to witness to him. And so when Peter in Acts 2 and Paul in Acts 9, both first spoke in public, once they'd been commissioned, they preached the gospel. They said, this is what you guys have to do, the necessity to take personal responsibility over your own life and give your life to Christ. And that's what the call is today. The call upon all of us to repent and turn from our own ways and to come into a relationship with God, because that is the greatest thing in the world. There is nothing like that. There is nothing like knowing Jesus. There is nothing like the glorious and wonderful gospel that changes lives, changes people. And look at where you are now and ask yourself that question. Have I surrendered to the personal call of God? If we look at this parable, and I'm just going to bring the end of the parable that I mentioned at the beginning, where Jesus says those words in Matthew 22 verses 11 to 14. And I'll read it to you just towards the end of this parable. So what's happened, of course, if you know the parable, you know it. If you don't, well, there's been a wedding. A king has had a wedding for his son. He's set up all the staff. He's got the DJ in, and he's got the PA system. He's got the food. He's got everything ready. And he's invited all those that know him. And he said, come to the wedding. And they said, oh, we can't be bothered. And all this sort of stuff. And some of them killed his servants. So he said, right, okay, wipe them out, kill them. And let's invite everyone else. Anyone, good or bad, who wants to come to the wedding, you can come. And so he fills up the wedding feast. But then there's this guy, okay? And it says it here. But when the king had come in to see the guests, he saw a man there who did not have on a wedding garment. So he said to him, friend, how did you come in here without a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Then the king said to his servants, bind him hand and foot. Take him away and cast him into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen. You know what? Sometimes people come scruffy to weddings, don't they? I've seen it before. Now, my son-in-law is here photographing somewhere, and he does a lot of weddings. And there's some people, you know, you don't want them in the photo, do you? Why did you turn up like that, you know? I'm sure they've not done it at weddings, you know. But it does happen. Oh, there he is. You know, but the king can see this guy a mile off, okay? He can see him. Why aren't you wearing a wedding garment? You know, I remember, right, when I first said, as a preacher, as an AOG minister, I'm not going to wear a tie anymore. I'm fed up with wearing a tie on a Sunday. I wear it all week. And then, some people will be offended by that, you know, if you don't wear a tie. So I said, well, I'm going to do it. It didn't sort of change my ministry or anything. Nobody left the church, as far as I know. But I've got a friend, right? He is an Elim minister down in Cornwall. And he's a surfer dude, right? So Matt's really cool, and unlike me. And so he said, when I started my ministers in training, he said, I went to the ministers in church, and he said, I had my flip-flops and my shorts, he said, and quite a loud shirt. He said, and I walked in, and this man in this suit said, and why are you here, sonny? He said, oh, I'm here for the ministers in training. He said, have you come to help, like, with the catering? He said, no, I'm a minister in training. He went,
dressed like that? He said, when I was a young minister, he said, we weren't allowed to own a pair of slippers. He said, because if someone came around your house and they needed ministry, they wouldn't see the minister in his slippers. He would have to be dressed formally. Can you believe that? You got a good pair of slippers, Mark, at home? I've got nice comfy ones. Are they sort of themed ones, you know, maybe that sort of thing? Yeah, it's got pom-poms on them. That's good, yeah. You see, so times have changed, haven't they? Times have changed. But, you know, this parable is not about dressing smart at church. See, it's not about dressing smart at all. In fact, I put a pair of jeans on this morning. Liz said, they're a bit scruffy. You better put the other ones on. Right, so, yeah. So I'm smart today. There you go. You know, it's not about dressing smart at church. It is about the righteousness of Christ. That is what this is about. So that when the king is God, okay, and he looks upon this man and he said, I can see you, but something's not right. Because he was not in a relationship with God. That is what the parable is saying, okay? It's a story to give a picture. And what it is saying is that we as believers have the righteousness of Christ so that when God looks upon us, he doesn't see our sin, he doesn't see our failures, he doesn't see the things that we've done wrong, he sees Christ. Yeah. And he smiles upon us. So that on that day when we come to the great wedding feast, which is what this parable is really about, on that final judgment day, God will not look at what we have done because our works won't work for anything. He will look upon us and see Jesus' righteousness. And he will say, welcome to the wedding. And I'm looking forward to that wedding day, aren't you? So what is the difference between the general call of God and the specific call of God on our lives? You know, the general call of God is always anchored in our responsibility to preach the gospel. But we have a personal call of God that suits our personality and our character and our giftings. Or the giftings, of course, grow as well. Now, you've heard the term, haven't you? God has a plan for my life. When my children were young, we had a song by some children singer, and they used to play this song all the time. So I've got it embedded in my head in little children's voices. God has a plan for my life. Did you join in? So it goes on and on in my head. Do you remember that? He's up there. My son. You know, some people are so focused on the plan that they forget the purpose. They think, oh, what's God's plan? What's going to happen in my life? What are all the good things? But our plan will always point people to Jesus. That's what it's about. It will always bring glory to his name. It will always absorb us and control us in that we want to bring glory to Jesus and tell other people about what he's done in our lives. You know, are you satisfied and comfortable with your life? Have you settled down? Do you find that you are just happy where you are in God? You know, I'm not talking about having God's peace and understanding his love, okay, but I'm talking about that unsatisfiable satisfaction that Smith Wigglesworth spoke about. Is there a desire in your life to fulfill God's plan? Or are you saying, well, it's probably too late for me. I'm stuck in a rut maybe, you know. What do I mean by that? Well, you know, if you drive a car across a field, you've got to be careful there's not ruts in the field. At the Assemblies of God General Conference in the early 90s, I'm going to make a confession to you now. Okay, it was in Minehead. There was about 8,000 believers there. And I went there with a group of people, lads in their late teens and early 20s, and we rented a chalet, and it was at Butlins and Minehead, and we got up to all sorts of things. At one time, one of our guys borrowed a disabled car from the facilities and drove it round in the chalet. I came back, and they were driving a car in the chalet. That was fun. But then one night, now there was a curfew on the camp, okay, because Christians behaved themselves in those days. And so there was a curfew on the camp, and you weren't allowed to go out of the camp. And so these other guys in my chalet decided they would. So Derek, my friend Derek, and a few of the other guys went out in his red Cortina to drive around North Devon. I don't ask me why. But anyway, 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm asleep. And I get woken up. Derek's car's on the railway line. On the railway line? And the visions of Derek, you know, you know, picture in these films, he's sitting in his car and there's a train coming. I'm thinking, railway line? They said, yeah, come and help him. So anyway, we go out at 3 o'clock in the morning trying to avoid. And what he's done is he's discovered, or they've discovered, that the only way back into the camp at that time in the morning was on the scenic railway, okay, which had an entrance that went down to the town. And they didn't have any gates on it, so you could come along the scenic railway and get into the camp. So he decides to drive along the scenic railway, but of course the railway rises as the ground falls, and his car got grounded. And they said, oh, come and help us. So there we were, 3 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock by then, avoiding security, going around to the maintenance department and finding some bits of wood so he could lever his car off the railway line and get into the camp. Now that's a secret, isn't it? Because they might fire me from being an AOG minister if I tell you that. So don't tell anyone, don't record it. All right, so, but you know, sometimes life can be like that. We can be going along and we hit a rut, okay? And it just stops us in our tracks. Maybe those things you've dreamed of, maybe those things you've prayed for, maybe those things that God has called you to, they've gone. because you've got yourself in a rut. And you said, well, that was then, and this is now. Maybe we've lost the desire to keep pursuing God and to fulfill what God has for us in our lives. Do we know what God has specifically called us to? Of course, he's not going to reveal the whole plan at once. Or have we ever asked him? Is it too scary a question? Maybe he might say, stop doing that and do this. Maybe we don't want that sort of question. Are we really willing to surrender our lives to the purposes of God? Are we willing to give up what we want and have an eternal perspective on everything that we do? If you think of Elijah and Elisha, okay, Elijah called Elisha to serve him. And initially it was a bit of a conversation, but what Elisha did was to take his oxen and to slaughter them. And he took the plow and everything and he set a fire and he invited everyone and had a big meal with the beef, a nice beef barbecue. But then it was all gone. It's good. Beef barbecue, come on, Anna. And it was gone. Everything. He said, I've burnt everything. This was my livelihood. This is what I lived on. And all of you have seen that I've burnt it all and I've gone to serve the purposes of God in my life. And of course, a bit later on, when you go into 2 Kings chapter 2, you find there that the Elijah says to Elisha, I'm going here. And he says, I'm coming with you. And on three occasions, at Bethel, at Jericho, and at the River Jordan, Elijah says, wait here while I go on. He says, I'm not going anywhere. And under oath, he said, I'm going to be with you. Because he wanted to pursue the call of God in his life. And he wanted that anointing upon his life. He wanted what God had for him. It was a test. Of course it was. And he pursued and he pursued. He was persistent in receiving what God had for him. We know that, don't we? We have to have that persistence, that drive to fulfill what God has for us in our lives. And we'll make mistakes, of course, we will along the way. We want to pursue it. What's the third question? How do we know the call of God? You know, as I said, God will never tell you the whole plan. That's why it's called faith. But there will be difficult times. You know, let me ask you a question. How do you know what your children want for dinner? I know that's not a straightforward question. Or how do you know what your wife wants for her birthday or what your children like going on holiday to? It's because you know them, don't you? I know it sounds simple. It's because you know people. I know it's still a hard thing sometimes. I know, what do I buy Elizabeth for her birthday? But you know what I mean? Because you know people, you know what they don't like. And so you try and get them something that they like. And when you're in a relationship with God, this may seem like a simple illustration, but when you're in a relationship, when you push in on him, when you're intimate with God, then you'll begin to understand when he's speaking to you and when he isn't. Sometimes he doesn't say anything and you have to keep pursuing. But, you know, following Jesus is something we do physically, but sometimes we neglect the spiritual side, that intimacy of pushing in. And sometimes that can be what stops us fulfilling the purpose of God in our life. You know, the prevalent culture around us is secular right now. In fact, in anything, it's pagan. And what do we mean by pagan? Well, paganism is not painting yourself, your body in paint and going up to Stonehenge in a silly hat. Some people do that. That is not paganism. Paganism just takes God out of the question. That's what it is. That's why it's so prevalent today. And at the root of our culture today is self-achievement, isn't it? It's, you know, taking joy in man's existence and what he can achieve himself. And that's the culture is around us. You can get there, you know, you're optimistic about human progression. Well, I'm not optimistic about anything that man can do. Because it's always ended in failure and war and disease and famine and arguments. It's always ended up in that. It's only God's plan and God's purposes in our lives that we need. You know, the lie of Satan right at the beginning to man was, you can do that. You'll be like God. You won't die. You're no good and evil. It's the same message we get today. You don't need God. You can do it yourself. You can make your own way. Maybe I've gone from the micro to the macro, I know, in what I'm saying there. But, you know, this morning, if you're a believer in Jesus, God has a call on your life, a specific call for a purpose and a plan that he wants to fulfill. And we need to press in and listen to God to develop intimacy. I think today, if anything, if the church in the UK and maybe if you're overseas as well listening lacks, is intimacy with God. Intimacy. When was the last time you were silent before God and just listened to him? When was the last time you didn't need your favorite song to get you on a high? Sorry to say that. Or you didn't depend on anyone else. When was the last time you pressed in and were intimate with God? You know, God cannot call you if you don't listen to him in the first place. And we've got to take that time. You know, Saul's revelation moment, if you like, was in an unregenerate state, okay? He was going completely against God's plan. He had a dramatic experience. Maybe it won't be like that. But once he had come to that place, we know if you look at his life and you read it in the book of Acts and in the letters, he spent time with God. Sometimes long periods, sometimes short periods. That's how he grew in his ministry. It was punctuated by spending time with God. And we've got to make time for that. We've got to. You know, there are many other specific things that I could say this morning, but, you know, God has a call on your life. You know, let's talk about missing the call of God, because I remember when I was a young believer, okay, I was in a church at Dartford, and we had two missionaries came from China, and I remember it to this day. So there's the lady, she's playing a grand piano, because we had a grand piano in a church, and the man was preaching. And they, at the end, they told us about their work, I can't remember what they said, but at the end they said, God is calling somebody here to serve him. God is calling somebody to serve him. And the call was very clear, and nobody responded. But I felt God calling me. And I thought, oh, I should go out there. I should respond. And we had quite a long aisle and a big area at the front. And I thought, I need to go out. And I felt the pressure so much. But no one else went out. I don't want people to laugh at me, I thought. I'm not a young Christian at the time. And eventually they said, okay then. About five times they said it. And then they finished. It was a hard lesson for me, and ignoring what God was calling upon my life. And it was fear of man. What would people think of me, the only person going out the front? I'm not knowing any, and I thought I might end up, if I go out the front, they will take me away in their car, and I'll be on a plane to China before I know it. And yeah, you know, that was, in a simple thinking, my fear, and fear of man, and what God's call was, that I didn't go out there. And I was really distressed by it. And that night I had a dream. And I might have shared this before. I had a dream. And I was, in this dream, I was, Casey's mine. And I was running along a dock, running. And I got to the end of the dock. And there's the boat. And I said to the guy, where's the China boat? He says, gone. It's out there. I mean, it scared the life out of me. Obviously, I took some counsel. And they said, no, it doesn't mean you're supposed to be in China now. You know, they gave me wise counsel. And they said, it is a reminder by God, though, not to ignore him when he calls you. I have ignored him other times since then, but I still remember that. That reminds me. Not all of us are called to go into full-time ministry. That's not what I'm saying here. You know, if you work in Aldi, if you're a sports coach or a nurse or a bus driver, whatever you may do, God may have called you into that, and that has equal value because you are fulfilling the purposes of God in your life. I remember an illustration by Pastor Ashmalowo, you may have heard of him. He talked about this motorway that has 10 lanes, and actually, have you ever been behind someone who's middle laning it? I hope you don't do that. I'm watching you. Middle laning it on the motorway, so you get a couple of lanes. He talks about being in different lanes and you've got to be in the right lane for your speed. Otherwise, you're holding other people up. Now, if you've been behind someone who's middle laning it at 35 miles an hour or 45 on the third middle lane of the motorway and all the traffic's trying to get around the outside, you know, if you're in the wrong place, okay, if you're in the wrong place, not only are you not fulfilling your purpose, but you hold up other people's purpose as well. Do you know that? You become a blockage. And so don't do that. You know, we have to find out where we are. And so, you know, no amount of professional development and coaching and training and encouragement will help you to fulfill if you want to go into the full-time ministry if God has not called you into it. You don't want to be a pastor. Okay? You don't want to be one if God hasn't called you to, because I've seen people in that place and it's not pretty. You know, the thing about being a pastor is that, like, you come and do your pastor job every 1 week and all these people come in and they're horrible to you, you know? It's not this church, of course. And then the problem is they come back next week and they're horrible as well, because it's the same people when they go to your church. But no, it doesn't happen here, of course, does it? But, you know, it can be like that sometimes for some people who are in the pastoral role. So, you know, maybe God isn't calling you to leave and go overseas as in a mission role or as a pastor or in a sort of leadership role. Don't seek that if God hasn't called it to you. But maybe God is. Maybe God is saying he wants you to stop what you're doing now and start fulfilling something else in your life. Maybe he said it to you 5 years ago, 10 years ago. Maybe he's saying to you right now that he wants you to think about what God is saying to you. Because don't be 10 years, 20 years, 30 years down the road and think, I should have done that. Yeah, God loves us. Of course he forgives us. Of course he will fulfill purposes and plans. But if you want to feel God's plan in your life, then you need to listen to God. Because the call of God is not about position or power or money or achievement. It's about servanthood. It's about servanthood. You know, maybe it's a different environment today, but when I became a believer in 1987, the pastor's son of the church I was in, He and his wife had just gone to Spain as missionaries a couple of years earlier with their family. And I spoke to Peter this week. He's still there. That was 1985. And if you know him and his kids, who have all married Spaniards, you wouldn't know they were British. They are so buried in their culture. Their Spanish is perfect. And they are just, you know, as far as they were concerned, God has called us, and that's our lives. We've sowed it. And they sowed their lives. And they've been tough times for them. I know that. I've known them through the years. But he's still there, serving. And he's not coming home. He's there to serve God in the purpose. So whatever we're called to do, sow yourself. Sow yourself into it. Except a grain of wheat will fall. You just don't see fruit without the grain, without the seed being sown, do you? You know, it always includes self-denial. John the Baptist said, he must increase and I must decrease. You know, I can hear John saying that with joy. When I hear John saying those words, I read them in the gospel, he is joyful that he's done the purpose of God in his life. Then God called him home. Grisly end. But God called him home. He said, right, you've done what I called you to do, John. It's time to come home. And those words of joy by John there. You know, the other thing is that when God calls us to something, it always has to be a light touch. You know, we never own anything that God calls us to. He can always say to you, well, actually, I don't want you to do that anymore. Sometimes we can get our identity in what we do, and that is a mistake. When God begins to grow us in a ministry or an area or a gifting, and sometimes we shift our identity from our identity in Christ and we shift it into that thing that we're doing. And then you get these things, and I'm not criticizing anyone, but this would sound really awful to me, Brian Greenaway Ministries type things, you know, where everything is focused on themselves and fulfilling what they want to do. We've got to be wary of that. But we've got to be weary of our attitude, or wary of our attitude as well. You know, the call of God and bringing glory to Jesus is what is at the center of all that we're doing. You know, when God uses us, here's the lesson. Get out of the way. Don't get in the way of what God is doing, even though God is using you at the time. Does that make sense? Don't think, oh, I've arrived. Oh, it's me. Have you ever heard of William Carey? I'm sure some of you will. The shoemaker who never really made enough money. His employer was a believer, and so he became a believer too. And he just felt the call of God upon his life, despite discouragement, despite people saying, oh, don't go. I mean, I think it was a church leader who said to him, oh, when God wants to convert the heathen, he'll do it themselves. He doesn't need your help. I mean, strange thing to say. But, you know, he went through some really tough experiences, but he prepared himself for the service of God. So he taught himself New Testament Greek. Then he taught himself Hebrew. Then he taught himself Latin, because it was important language at that time for that. But what he said was, I may not be the most gifted person, but I can plod. I love that word. I can plod. You know what that means? It means just putting one foot in front of another. Now, when he went on the mission field, they had tragedy. Children passed away. His wife had mental health problems. It was a tough time. But the first sermon he preached before he left was titled, Expect Great Things from God and Attempt Great Things for God. You know, 7 years after arriving, he had his first convert, 7 years. He finished his translation of the New Testament into Bengali. And over the next 28 years, he and his team translated the entire Bible into India's major languages, Bengali, excuse me if I can't pronounce these right, Oriya, Marathi, Hindi, Assamese, and Sanskrit, and parts of 209 other languages and dialects. He spent 41 years in India without furlough. You know, his mission couldn't count more than maybe 700-800 converts, but he laid the foundation for Bible schools and churches and the growth of the work in India that is there still today, because he decided to put one foot in front of the other in the purposes of God, despite opposition, despite people saying, don't do it, despite his own problems, family issues that he faced, he pushed on in God and made a difference that we see a legacy of today. Probably people in this room, people listen to me online, a descendants of that legacy. So what I'm saying to you today is, don't miss out on God's calling. If God has called you to do a certain job, and I don't say secular because everything is spiritual, wherever you are, then do that with all your heart. And remember that your general call is to preach the gospel. But maybe today God is stopping you in your tracks. Maybe he's saying to you, online or in here, this is what I want you to do. I want you to change what you're doing. I want you to reorientate your life so that you can fulfill the purpose of God today. Let's pray together, shall we? Father God, we thank you for your great love for us. We thank you that Jesus answered the call of God. He came down as a man and he lived upon this earth for 33 years. And we know at one time he prayed, not my will, but yours be done, because he saw the cross before him. But he didn't falter. He gave his life for us. And we thank you for these apostles, these prophets, these men and women of God who gave their lives to the gospel, not living their lives unto, you know, worldly fame. But most of them, Lord, most of the apostles were martyred. They lived their lives to the full. And then you said, come home. You've done what I need you to do. Lord, I pray that you will just re-envision us, that you would fill us with the Holy Spirit and call us into the purposes and plans you have for us. Lord, we want to fulfill that purpose. If we fulfill that plan and purpose, we know that you would impact other people's lives as well. So help us, Lord. We give ourselves to you today. We ask, Lord, that you would just work in our hearts, that you would draw us, Lord, into that closer intimacy and relationship with you. And you begin to speak to us and begin to direct our lives into what you have for us. In Jesus' name, I pray. Now, there may be some here where our eyes are closed. There may be some you are saying, you know, I feel that God is calling me either into a relationship with him, or that God is calling me into a different area, a different plan, a different purpose. And I want you to acknowledge that. Well, no one else is looking. No one else is looking. And even online, you know, by just raising your hand. Just raise your hand to God today to say that. To say, Lord, I'm going to push in on you. And I'm not even looking myself, because that's between you and God. And I want you to just raise your hand and say, God, I just want to acknowledge that today. And I'm going to pray for you specifically. Father God, I pray for those today who are acknowledging something before you. It's personal to them. It may be there's various different reasons why. But Lord, I pray that you will just fill them with your Spirit. Lord, you'll give them that desire that is stronger than anything else, Lord, to fulfill your purposes and plan in their life. I pray for them now that you will encourage them, you will bless them, you will speak to them even during this week of prayer and fasting. You will speak to them clearly, that they will hear the call and respond and begin to take one step in front of another to fulfill the purposes of God in their lives for this generation, in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. You can put your hands down now. Bless God.
Brilliant, brilliant, brilliant. Worship team, join me. We're going to come to the end of our service now. And maybe you did respond just now to Brian's invitation and you would like to talk to him, myself, and maybe pray with us. We would be happy to do that. And there are others that could also be there to support prayer time if there's a need for that after the service. So we're going to really just stand now. So why don't we stand? And Sophie and the team are going to lead us through another song, and then we're going to move our service forward. So thank you, Sophie and the guys.
I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. I see his love and mercy washing over all I see. The people sing, the people sing, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna.
Father, as we, Lord, as we have just worshipped again and heard a great message, Lord, motivating us to recognize your call. Lord, thank you that that call is so real, that, Lord, you've called every one of us. Lord, you've invited every one of us to that wedding. Lord, we've been invited. And Lord God, not everyone has responded. But Lord, we have, and our desire is to be faithful, to carry that Matthew 18 responsibility, Lord, to know what it means to make disciples and to just carry the responsibility for our faith seriously. Lord, forgive us for the times when that's not been so on it. But today, Lord God, our desire is to be on it and to focus right and to be, Lord, faithful to your call. Lord, for those who've sensed a call above and beyond just the invitation, which is so powerful and so important, Lord, to the gospel, but Lord, a sense of further responsibility, we pray, Lord, that they will know confirmation and they'll see the signpost, they'll have that witness and strength in their hearts. Lord God, thank you, Lord, that you lead and guide and you change ourselves, you change our communities, you change our countries, and you change the nations. when we're obedient and we follow you, Lord God. So, Lord, thank you this morning for our time together. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. We're going to have a final song and play the service out. But before I do, I just want to say it would be really helpful if you're coming to the International Feast next Sunday just to let us know you're coming and give us an indication of numbers. So you can do that through our calendar. Just let us know so we've got an idea of what to set up for. And just be prepared for that. It helps us with the volunteering thing. But there's no fee for coming. It's just an invitation. Just bring food and bring yourselves and bring your friends and all the other stuff. So we're going to play ourselves out this morning with a song. So thank you, Sophie. This is in the song. And then we will close the service down. Thank you. Well, it's been an excellent morning this morning. Let's show our appreciation to Pastor Brian, the worship team. And of course, we always appreciate the kids workers on the other side. Thank you to those who are in the services today. If you're brand new to the church, it'd be great to meet with you. And if you would like prayer, just feel free to come forward. Look forward to seeing you very, very soon. God bless and take care. Have a